Good morning and welcome to our services. It's a good day to be together. Glad to have everyone here. Obviously, it's a travel season, a lot of people out of town, but we are thankful for every one of us who is in town and is here this morning. It is good to have our Honduras group back. I assume they all made it back. They sort of trickled in over about 3 or 4 days there, but I assume they're all back and getting ready, as Josh mentioned, to head off to camp now, some of the same people, but glad they had a safe trip, and we'll be hearing about it more in the coming weeks. From the very beginning of human history, God has had a plan and a will for mankind. It has been God's desire to have a close relationship with mankind now, and an even closer relationship in eternity. And to carry out that plan, God has often called people to accomplish certain tasks in His kingdom. Often those tasks have seemed daunting from the human perspective. How can we ever do what God has called us to do? But in every case, God has equipped the people He has called with the blessings and the abilities needed to do whatever it is that He has entrusted to them to do. This series of lessons is about God's plan for the church and about our responsibilities for contributing to the successful completion of those plans. In the book of Ephesians, God teaches Christians about the church and about God's plan for the church. The church is a unique, truly one-of-a-kind group of people who have been brought together through Christ to accomplish God's will for the church. And as the letter progresses, he describes what we are to do, how we are to do it, and what God has done to equip us to do that. But before we go into Ephesians this morning and look at what Paul says about our role in God's plan, we're going to take a quick look at several historical precedents where God has given people a role to play in His plan and has equipped them to fulfill that role. None of these stories will be new to us. We know them fairly well, but the context may be a little bit different from the way we normally look at them. And I hope we'll see a connection between these Old Testament stories and Paul's words to the Ephesian Christians, again, possibly in a bit different light than the connections we normally make. If anything, I hope that we'll see that the letter to the Ephesians is more methodical and more purposeful than we may often realize. God has always endowed His human creations with certain unalienable responsibilities and the ability to meet those responsibilities. In Genesis chapter 1, we have a summary statement about the first couple in verses 27 and 28. So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them. Then God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." Notice the bullet points. He created them, He blessed them, and then He gave them responsibilities. Blessings are more than just the nice things that God gives us and does for us. Blessings also include the tools and the abilities that are needed to carry out the responsibilities that He gives us. God never tells us to do anything that He doesn't in some way equip us to do. In Genesis chapter 12, God informed Abraham that He was going to work through Abraham to produce a great nation and to bless all nations. In chapter 15, God appeared to Abraham in a vision, and Abraham had some questions about the role that God had given to him. Basically, Abraham didn't see how he could produce a great nation when he didn't even have one child. And he was already 75 years old. God assured him that he would have the child that he needed, and 25 years later, he gave him that child. In Genesis chapter 4, God spoke to Moses, gave him the responsibility of speaking to the Pharaoh of Egypt and of leading the Israelites out of Egypt. Moses claimed that he didn't have the skills necessary for such a task. And God assured him that God would bless him with every needed skill. In Exodus chapter 4, verses 10 through 12, "Then Moses said to the Lord, 'O my Lord, I am not eloquent. Neither before nor since you have spoken to your servant, but I am slow of speech and slow of tongue.' So the Lord said to him, 'Who has made man's mouth? Or who makes the mute, the deaf, the seeing, or the blind? Have not I, the Lord? Now therefore, go, and I will be with your mouth and teach you what you shall say.'" After the Israelites escaped from Egypt, God gave detailed instructions for the construction of the tabernacle and for all the beautiful furnishings that would go in the tabernacle. As slaves in Egypt, the Israelites were shepherds converted into bricklayers and stonemasons. But the tabernacle had no brickwork and no stonework in it. So how were they going to do all this skilled carving and artwork and metalwork? Well, God gives the answer to that in Exodus chapter 31, beginning in verse 1. "Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, 'See, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, the son of the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom, in understanding, in knowledge, and in all manner of workmanship, to design artistic works, to work in gold and silver and bronze, in cutting jewels for setting, in carving wood, and to work in all manner of workmanship.'" And then how was this nation of shepherds turned bricklayers turned carpenters? How were they going to invade and conquer established nations living in fortified cities? We don't have time to read the entire answer, that is the full text of Deuteronomy chapter 6, 7, 8, and 9, but a couple of verses should serve as a summary of that. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 17 through 19, "You shall diligently keep the commandments of the Lord your God, His testimonies and His statutes which He has commanded you. And you shall do what is right and good in the sight of the Lord, that it may be well with you, and that you may go in and possess the good land of which the Lord swore to your fathers, to cast out all your enemies from before you, as the Lord has spoken." God calls, God informs, and God equips. It is a pattern that is repeated countless times throughout sacred history, and it's no different in the church today. In previous lessons, we have looked at the big picture of what God wants to do through the church. The first thing that we read about in Ephesians that God has done for us is to bless us. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, "He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ." What do these spiritual blessings include? Well, probably, most obviously, salvation, forgiveness of sins, eternal hope, and all of those good things. But blessings could also include the abilities or the potential abilities to faithfully accomplish all that He expects His people to accomplish. Later in chapter 2, verse 10, we learn that God has blessed us, that is, the church. He has created the church to do the good works that He has prepared for us to do. Chapter 2, verse 10, "For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Paul concludes his big picture part of the letter by assuring us that this assembly of saved people called the church can accomplish more than we could ever have imagined. Just like Moses at the burning bush and Israel invading the promised land. Ephesians 3 verses 20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. God has lofty goals for the church and for the people in the church, and he equips us to accomplish those goals. But those goals may not be always exactly what we might have expected them to be. When we think of the great things that we can accomplish as a church, we might think of big congregations and eloquent preachers and exciting worship events. God might be thinking more of transformed godly lives and pure relationships and that type of thing. Those are certainly more ambitious and more elusive than what often passes as powerful religious accomplishments. We are then at the beginning of chapter 4 called to walk worthy of this godly calling. We looked at that last week. We are to do that. We are to have that worthy walk in an environment of lowliness, gentleness, patience, and bearing with one another. And we might wonder how a group of forgiven but still very human people are going to do that. And so Paul proceeds to tell us what God has done so that we can be and do what God expects us to be and do. Paul mixes his metaphors a bit. He's known for that. But he pursues the imagery of the church as both a structure and a body. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, he gets into his body-building presentation. Verses 11 and 12, rereading those, he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body in Christ. Of key importance is the fact that God gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, and pastor teachers to the church. He is not saying here that he gave the assignment or the ability to certain men to be apostles and to be prophets and to be the other things. Now that would have been a true statement because God did call certain people to fill certain roles and equip them to fulfill those roles. But that's not what he is saying here. The meaning here is that God gave those people with those functions as a gift to the church. How are we going to learn to work together as the people whom God has joined in one body and one spirit and one Lord and one faith and so on? Well, part of the answer is he has given us people to equip us. Already back in chapter 2, verse 20, he has identified the apostles and prophets as the initial foundation, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. In addition to the foundation, which is only laid once, was laid in the first century, he meets our ongoing needs with evangelists and teachers. It may be clearer in this verse, particularly verse 12, if we remove just for a moment the specific roles that he mentions. That would leave us with this phrase, he himself gave some to equip the saints. He is, in fact, answering the question of how we can learn to walk worthy of our calling and how to develop lowliness and gentleness. One thing God has done to help us learn all of that is he has given us the first century apostles and prophets, and he continues to give us spiritual overseers and teachers. He then gets more specific in explaining why God has given us people with these roles. I'm reading from the New King James Version, and in verse 12, it uses the word for, F-O-R, three times. It has for the equipping, for the work, for the edifying. But in the original, the first of those fours is a different word from the other two. And that distinction should help us to understand more clearly exactly what Paul is saying. The English Standard Version, for example, says that he has given these roles to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. In other words, Christ hasn't given apostles, prophets, evangelists, and elders to the church for three things, that is, for equipping, for working, for building up. He has given us these gifts for one thing, for equipping, to equip the saints. And that equipping is then in two areas. First, we are equipped to do the work of ministry or to serve. And second, we are equipped to build up the church to maturity. Now, that distinction between two and four and different words there might sound like a small quibble over a minor detail, but it's not. We don't have elders and preachers and even less apostles and prophets to do all the work of ministry and to do all the building up. Those people have the role of equipping everyone to serve and to help each other grow. It makes a big difference in how we see the church and how we organize to do the work of a healthy church. For example, the church is not to have a cult-style structure with a spiritual dictator who tells everyone else what to do. It is to have spiritual leaders and teachers who equip others to work and to grow. This becomes even clearer in the next verse. This equipping for service and for growth is an ongoing process with a purpose. The purpose is that everyone will come to a greater unity of faith and greater spiritual maturity. Verse 13. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. It's true that God has work for the church to do, and it's true that God has a purpose for what the church does. But it is also true that God's purpose is met only when the members of the body are progressing together. It's tempting for church leaders to focus sometimes too much on getting things done, even if that means doing it all themselves. Big churches tend to have a lot of paid staff, and they count on the staff to make sure the work gets done. Small churches tend to expect the preacher to do everything, and if he doesn't, the church is unhappy with him, and he gets discouraged because the members aren't involved. God wants the work of the church to be done by as many growing, maturing Christians as possible. And we must not forget that the growing and the working need the healthy environment of lowliness and patience and gentleness and bearing with one another. Paul gives more information about the body of united, maturing Christians in verses 14 and 15. That we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, Christ. Part of spiritual maturity, not all of it, but part of spiritual maturity involves doctrinal stability. We know that a lot of biblical concepts involve a measure of balance that avoids one extreme or another. Stability in doctrine is one of those concepts that needs balance. One extreme of so-called stability would be to never accept any new idea or new understanding of anything spiritual, which in essence is a claim to infallibility. The other extreme is the one that Paul addresses here. This is what Paul describes as being tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine. There is a great danger in wanting to always be on the cutting edge of every new fad or trend. And again, I'll say, sometimes new is good. But real spiritual maturity will be very discerning. Maturity will be discerning in what we reject and why we reject it. But spiritual maturity will also be discerning in what we accept. I don't want to paint too broad of a brush, but let me give an example of at least one area where we need to be careful and discerning. We live in a very commercialized world. And the religious world is not exempt from the commercialization. Commercialization means that a product needs to sell. And to sell, the products have to have new ideas, or at least old ideas wrapped up in a new package. It might be a book or a video or a seminar on discipleship or church growth or marriage or family or finances or whatever. But sales will be more determined by what is new than by what is true. So buyer, beware. Not every new idea or approach should be adopted. We are to be discerning. Now, we can address such issues by going back to those church structure ideas of the preceding verses. We can have spiritual rulers who dictate or who try to dictate what you're allowed to read and what you're allowed to watch and where you're allowed to go. That way we can protect members from false doctrine, which is a good objective. Or church leaders can equip members to study and to think and to discern what is edifying and what is not. And members can accept their responsibility to study and to think and to discern what is edifying and what is not. And we can discuss those things among ourselves and encourage and guide each other. And that's the system that Paul is describing here. To protect each other from the dangers that are lurking, Paul calls us to speak the truth in love. This is a beautiful phrase that makes me cringe whenever I hear it. The truth spoken in love is a beautiful thing. What can be more beautiful and edifying than truth spoken with love? And it's hard to imagine the strength of a church where only truth is spoken, and it is always spoken in love. But the phrase itself makes me cringe because the quality called love is claimed more often than it is practiced. It's not just in male-female relationships that the word love is misused and abused. Here's a rule of thumb for speaking the truth in love. Just a rule of thumb, general idea. If you have to tell me that you love me as you are telling me something that you don't think I'm going to enjoy hearing, you're going to have a hard time convincing me that the love is really genuine. Now, it may be genuine, but you're going to have a harder time convincing me, especially if the way you tell me the truth doesn't sound loving. If you love me, you will go ahead and tell me truths that I need to hear, even if I don't want to hear them. But if you say that you are telling me because you love me, that still doesn't give you permission to demolish me or me to demolish you. There are people who could tell me some very unpleasant truths, and even if I didn't agree with them, I would listen attentively because I already know they love me. They've already demonstrated that. They've earned the credibility, and they've demonstrated and shown it and continue to show it as they speak to me. How can I tell that I am speaking the truth in love? How can you tell that you are speaking the truth in love? Well, maybe by going back to verse 2 of this chapter. Does that verse accurately say what you are saying and how you are saying it and why you are saying it? Lowly and gentle and patient and forbearing? Does verse 3 describe your words and your attitude? Are you making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace? Are you just wanting to make a point? Yes, indeed. Life in the body of Christ is different and makes different demands than in any other body. Much of the uniqueness of life in the church is summarized in verse 16. After just saying, mentioning Christ as the head, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. When I was growing up, sermons and classes on certain church doctrines were much more common than they are today, and there's good and bad to that, pros and cons. But one of these doctrines that we really emphasized was an anti-clergy doctrine. And we still believe this, we just don't talk about it as much. And this is simply that the New Testament doesn't authorize a clergy-laity distinction in the church. The church is not run by the clergy, with the laity simply being those who pay dues, attend meetings, and receive the benefits of membership. To teach the flatness of church hierarchy, we would go normally to certain passages. For example, we would go to 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9 and show that all Christians are a royal priesthood, rather than having a few ordained priests who get to wear special clothing and perform the religious rituals. And those are good passages, and that's a sound doctrine. But I don't know that I ever heard Ephesians 4:16 used in that discussion. But when you read it carefully, it is a powerful statement against anything like a clergy-laity system. Let's read it again. From whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Christ is the head of the church. All the members are joined and knit together by what every joint supplies. They depend on the effective working by which every part does its share. Every member is to be involved in causing the growth of the body and for edifying of itself in love. Who edifies the body? The body edifies itself. We the people have the responsibility of caring for we the people. Yes, up in verse 11, he mentioned four specific roles, but he didn't create a special class out of those people who fill those roles. And we've already looked at that verse. Their job is to equip everyone to do what verse 16 says. Each one of us should be asking ourselves, what can I do to help build up the body? And that's every elder and every preacher and every deacon and every class teacher and every person who sings the songs and every person who listens to the sermons. What can I do to help this church be the church that Paul described in Ephesians chapters 1, 2, and 3? What should I stop doing? Because it's harmful to the health of the body. And this isn't just about what we can do that fits into that big category of church work. Now, yes, there are certainly many important official church activities that depend on the participation of members. But there are others. How can I live my life on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday in a way that would benefit the church? When we are known for kindness and good works in our jobs and in our neighborhoods, that helps the church. If we have a bad reputation in those settings, even if we are admired within this room, that hurts the church. What can I pray? What can I pray about that would help this church? Now, I'm sure we pray for each other, especially health issues, But we should also pray for this congregation. I'm sure that many of us do. I do not want to sound like I'm accusing us of not praying for the health and the work of the congregation. But I want to remind us and encourage us to offer those prayers, because it is immensely helpful to the church when members of the church pray for the church. God has given the church the gift of certain people in certain roles, going clear back to the apostles and prophets, to equip the church for faithful service. And sometimes in our study of this passage, we go to great lengths to identify and define these terms and roles. We examine what the word apostle really means, and what it means to be an inspired prophet. And we study about evangelists and elders and the meaning of the word pastors. And those are all useful and valid uses of study time. But verse 11 is not the essence of this passage. This passage is about a body made of its members. And those members need to be growing, maturing members who accept their responsibilities for the well-being of the other members and the well-being of the body as a whole. We don't all have the same roles to fill in the church, but we all have a role and a place in the congregation that makes us all responsible for building up the body in love. This is the body for which Christ died. It's an exclusive body in the sense that only those who are in it receive the benefits of the sacrifice of Christ. But it's also an inclusive body, because every person alive is invited to yield his life to Christ as the head of the church and be added to the church. And God does that for everyone who believes in His Son, turns away from sin, and is buried with Christ in baptism. The offer is yours today if you are ready to accept it. And if you need the help of your church family as you strive to be the body member that you should be, we are here to help you with that as well. Let's stand and let's sing.